Are you sure you want to stay here? It looks creepy.
But Savannah,
you have now entered into the House of Mystery, 106.5 FM, KCAA Los Angeles, 1050 AM, Palm Springs and 102.3, San Bernardino, Riverside, the best in true crime, conspiracy and alternative history, with Al Warren and Kevin Thompson.
The sun is shining. So why binge in here when you can do it out there? With this clever little app called Audible, you can listen to the stories you love while doing the things you love outside. Everyone's doing it. She's binging, they're binging, and so is he. So put on your headphones, turn on Audible, and binge better.
Welcome back to the House of Mystery. This is Al Warren on KKNW 1150 AM Seattle and KCAA 106.5 FM Los Angeles. And Kev Thompson's here with me.
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
Yeah, another day. It's been an interesting day already. Now we've got another great guest joining us, and he's been an author of several books. Definitely, this is a great one I've been listening to. It's called Hell's Princess. And joining us is the author, Harold Schechter. Thank you for being here.
My pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.
You're welcome. So I had no idea. This was a story about Belle Gunness, and she is a serial killer of many men.
Correct. Yes, female serial killer, of which, you know, there actually have been quite a few, although they tend to commit their crimes differently from male serial killers. You know, they often murder with poison. Mm-hmm. But Belle, whose crimes were discovered in 1908, you know, is a very unusual, possibly unique case because she also enjoyed chopping up the bodies of her victims after they were dead, which, you know, that kind of butchery you don't usually find in women serial killers.
Yeah. Now, this happened in the, in the late 1800s?
Really more like the very early 20th century. As I said, her crimes were uncovered in 1908, and she had probably been at it, you know, for about 4 or 5 years before that.
Wow, that's crazy. How many people did we think that she killed, or how many did they discover on her property?
Well, they discovered roughly a dozen. I say roughly because it was a little difficult to say with precision because she had a habit of tossing the remains of more than one victim into these pits she dug in her hog lot. And also, the property wasn't completely dug up. The searchers basically stopped after they had dug up about a dozen. She also bumped off a couple of husbands before that for the insurance money. But in terms of the victims that she lured to her farm and then killed, about a dozen.
Wow. Now the first two husbands of hers she killed, kind of, she lived with them, were married, and she offed them, sort of. Maybe explain, was there, so that was a pretty normal, like she wasn't at a serial killer state in the very beginning.
Well, I'm not sure I'd use the word normal, but
Oh, look at today.
But yeah, I mean, that sort of crime was, not at all unknown. I mean, there had been a number of very, very notorious women poisoners back in the late 19th century in the United States who killed husbands and siblings and even children. Sometimes for the insurance money, sometimes because they had become too much of a burden, to take care of. So in that sense, those, I wouldn't have written my book, if Belle Gunness had stopped, with just poisoning a couple of husbands for insurance money. That isn't what ended up making her so notorious.
Right. So now after that, how did she start on this? Like, what was the basic scenario that she used, or kind of explain how she started getting into the serial killing business?
Yeah, I mean, was it more of a Black Widow situation?
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I mean, well, her modus operandi, after she killed her second husband, was she was a Norwegian immigrant, and she began putting matrimonial ads in Scandinavian language newspapers throughout the Midwest, in which she advertised herself not entirely accurately as a comely widow.
Okay.
She had this, large farmstead, very handsome property. She was looking for a man to become her partner, possibly with a view to matrimony. That applicant, should be guys who had some money because she would expect them to invest in the property. So she began to lure these lonely Norwegian, mostly bachelors, to this farm. Then she would apparently, we don't know absolutely 100% for sure, but she would apparently then, feed them a nice hearty Norwegian meal, which was spiked with arsenic, and then polish them off by bludgeoning them in the skull, and then drag their corpses down to the cellar of her house and chop up the bodies. So, there certainly was some kind of mercenary motive, but that doesn't really account for, the atrocity of her crimes. First of all, she was already pretty well off, so it's not as though she desperately needed the money. And secondly, it doesn't account for the evident pleasure she took, in committing this kind of butchery. Because she could have as easily disposed of the bodies without dismembering them first. So, there was some other sadistic component to the crimes, which made them, very, very horrific at the time, and, still very horrific to contemplate.
So this wasn't a slow process, because poison is generally a slow process. This was rather quick.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think she would, the guys, would not die immediately, but they would fall ill. And she was basically, trying to incapacitate them, because these were all farmers who were strong guys. I mean, there was some evidence that her last victim, had struggled with her, because they found in clutched in one of the hands, dismembered hands of the corpse, some hair. So apparently, so she, would have administered the poison to incapacitate them, And then apparently she would, deliver, a coup de grace, by hitting them in the head with some kind of sledgehammer or something, and then chop off their bodies.
So when you say that she, I'm trying to wrap my head around this, she would run ads, almost like a Craigslist looking for a husband. I mean,
exactly.
How do you respond to something like that? Do you just show up to the farmhouse and say, "Hey, I'm here"? I mean, how does that work?
No, yeah. Well, again, back then, when you couldn't just swipe on your cell phone or something, it was done through the mails. She would receive lots of letters. I mean, according to the local postman, she would be inundated with letters from these guys, and she would, sometimes conduct pretty extensive correspondence with them, and she would weed out, candidates that she didn't think were suitable, either because they didn't have enough money. She was also looking for men without a lot of family connections, so there wouldn't be a lot of people who became suspicious when they never showed up again. So this was done via mail. I mean, there's one, her final victim, was a guy named Andrew Helgelian. She and he corresponded over a course of 18 months, and there are about 80 or so extant letters still, which really shed light on how insidious she was in luring these guys to the farm. But it is sort of the equivalent of, Craigslist murder these days. Her ads.
Because here's my point. We're looking at a course of, from 1902, let's go all the way to 1908. And so we're looking at 6 years, and you said one gentleman she corresponded with for approximately a year and a half. So was she already involved with one when she was already selecting another?
Evidently, we don't, there's a lot of ambiguity about, her exact methods. I mean, she apparently died. We don't know. I mean, at the climax of all this, we're not absolutely sure of even that. So, the only real evidence we have of her method consists of, the existing letters between her and Helgelein, the testimony of the postmaster about the amount of mail she received, and so on and so forth. But apparently, once she had invited a guy to her farm, she she was sure that he had the money with him, or he wired for the money, and she had the money in her possession, she got rid of him right away. She was probably already, combing through her mail looking for her next victim.
So we're looking at a common theme here. Money was her motive.
Mm-hmm.
She was selecting, wealthy bachelors.
Well, they weren't wealthy, but they had, some of them had a fair amount of money, but they all had, a relatively substantial amount of money. So money was, there's one historian has called her Bluebeard with a profit motive. I think that captures something of the complexity of her motives. She was, by all accounts, a very, very money-hungry person. At the same time, she had already acquired a fairly substantial amount of money from having bumped off her two husbands and collected on their insurance policies. And she was also, the owner of this fairly handsome, substantial farmstead in LaPorte, Indiana. So, it wasn't that she was desperate for money. There's some cases of earlier female poisoners, who are really living in very, very dire circumstances. But at the same time, this is why she really was a female serial killer, because you can't attribute, the extent of her crimes purely to mercenary motives. You know, there's something else going on. You know, there are other ways, and there are other ways even back then, for women to support themselves, than by luring lonely bachelors to their, homes and killing them and chopping them up. You know, there was something else going on there. You know, there's a certain amount of what I would say is, sadistic pleasure in inflicting this kind of butchery on the bodies of her victims. So,
well, let's look at that. I mean, we're kind of, jesting about it, and I did catch on to the word comely. You know, I choose the word. She was a rather unfortunate looking woman, but what do you think happened in her past? What led her up to this point?
Well, we don't know for sure, because as with virtually all criminals of that kind, they're basically total obscure non-entities up until the moment that, they start making the front pages for having, gone on these horrible crime sprees. So there aren't a lot of, records about her early life. I mean, she grew up in a little village in Norway called Selbu. She was the daughter of a poor tenant farmer. The only records that really exist are things like baptismal records and so on. There were stories about her that began to circulate later on after her crimes were discovered, but it's hard to know how much validity, to give them. They often have the feel of sort of urban legends. There was a story, for example, that when she was a teenager, she was impregnated by the son of a wealthy landowner, who then beat her up and caused her to miscarry, and that this was a source of her hatred for men. But again, it's hard to know if that's really true or not. What one thing we could probably safely say, because this is common to the kinds of criminals we now call serial murderers, is that they often do suffer a lot of childhood humiliation, and there is some evidence that that was the case with Belle, that because of, her family was so very poor, and the kinds of drudgery that she was forced to perform as a child, that she was looked upon in the village, with a certain amount of scorn and contempt and so on. But again, it's all very, very speculative. We just don't have enough information about her background or her childhood, to know what created that kind of psychopathology.
Yeah, but we can kind of piece it together a little bit by her actions. For example, you said something that was very key that caught my attention, that she would oftentimes she would dispose of the bodies in, I believe you said, her hog pen.
Correct.
Now today we all know that if you really, really want to get rid of a body, you're going to feed it to hogs, because they will eat anything and leave actually very little behind. So, to me, that shows a lot of premeditation, and she gave a lot of thought to this.
Well, her crimes were absolutely premeditated. There's no question about that. And that's, one of the things that makes her so very sinister. I mean, that comes across very, very powerfully, if you read the correspondence between her and Andrew Elgellian, the really diabolical way she spent a year and a half, luring this poor guy into her clutches. So, that's certainly the case. It doesn't seem to be the case that she fed the dismembered bodies to her hogs. She apparently had one of her handymen dig these pits, which were supposedly for garbage disposal, and then she would toss the body parts in gunny sacks into these pits. But there's a degree of degrading, the bodies, degrading these victims, just treating them like farm animals, both in the way she chopped them up and then tossing them into this, you know, disgusting hog lot, you know, that I think you're right. I mean, that speaks volumes about her hatred, you know, her hatred of men, you know, where exactly, you know, this exactly where the source of that hatred is. Again, we don't know for sure, but.
Well, I don't know what kind of notes they took back then, but was there any signs, you know, and forgive this question, but were there any signs of sexual mutilation on these bodies?
Well, I'm not sure that, none that I know of. I mean, partly because I don't, you know, the condition of the bodies, you know, was so, you know, the bodies were so decomposed and so on for the most part, that I don't think that, you know, that could be easily determined. And I'm not even sure really how much, you know, how much, you know, the degree to which the bodies were autopsied or anything post-mortem. But as far as I know, I mean, that's an interesting question. And I have to confess, well, I certainly didn't come across any reference to that.
Yeah, because that would give us a little bit of insight into her mindset whenever she committed these murders.
Although, I'm not sure what phrase to use. I was going to say icing on the cake, but that would be inappropriate. But, you know, I mean, just, you know, even without that, you know, the extent to which she mutilated the bodies, you know, was so, you know, so extreme and so horrific that, you know, that's indicative, again, of this, you know, this hatred of, you know, of men.
I was just going to ask, Harold, the last handyman that she had was eventually accused of killing her in the fire. Now she was having an affair with him as well. And then she kicked him out eventually because she found another guy. Why didn't she kill him? Like, what was different about him, or do we know?
Well, she did have a number of handymen that she would, you know, conduct these sexual relationships with while they were living with her. You know, he was a useful, like, you know, he was a useful man to her. You know, there's some evidence that he perhaps might have even been something of an accomplice in her crimes. There's certainly strong suggestion that he was aware of her murders, and certainly the murder of the last victim, Helgelian. So, you know, I have always assumed that it was partly, you know, her sense of, that she could dominate. His name was Ray Lamphere. You know, that she could dominate Ray, you know, put him to some, you know, productive use. You know, it's hard to know how much, you know, how much longer he would have survived. But I think he served as a useful tool for her for a while. So,
yeah, I just kind of thought that it's strange because if he did know about the her conduct with these victims, that she would just let him go. Like, let, you know, basically replaced him with another guy and let him go, because he was quite angry. He seemed like he still really cared for her. So I would think she would be worried that he would tell the people, would let people know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think she was worried at the point at which they had their rift, which is why, among other reasons, she tried to get him declared insane. And, of course,
going on. Well, what's going on here?
Burn down the house. He would have, that would have been his motive, murdering her. So it's very, very possible. I mean, one possibility is, as, and again, this is one of the reasons my book is called The Mystery of Belle Gunness. You know, this mystery still clings to the whole question of what ultimately happened to her. You know, there are many, many people who believe that she torched the house herself, you know, that this whole thing at the end, which, you know, we haven't described, was a setup, and, you know, she had, You know, she had orchestrated this precisely in order to get Ray Lamphere, you know, convicted and hanged.
Right. Right. I mean, so, and there's also suspicions that she didn't really die in the fire as well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, the situation was, you know, that after, you know, she murdered Helgelian after spending, again, 18 months cultivating the relationship and finally succeeding in luring him to the farm and then getting him to wire all his money from his hometown bank to LaPorte. As soon as the money came, she murdered him. In the meantime, she had sent Ray Lamphere off on this wild goose chase, but he returned early. And there's some suggestion, you know, that he, you know, he witnessed her murder of Helgelian, you know, was possibly blackmailing her. You know, he, you know, was starting to pose a real problem to Belle. She couldn't murder him at that point because, you know, he was out of the house. And then Helgelian's brother discovered these letters from Belle Gunness in his missing brother's possession, you know, in the farmhouse of his missing brother. Who said he was going off to Indiana and then never returned. And so the brother was starting to, you know, poke around and things were really closing in on Belle. So she went into town, made out her will, told her lawyer that she was afraid that Ray Lamphere was going to murder her. And that very night, you know, her house burned to the ground and they found in the cellar the charred remains of this woman clutching the bodies of three children. The three children, you know, were indisputably Belle's children. But the woman, who was originally assumed to be Belle, you know, was missing her head. The corpse was missing its head.
Oh, how convenient.
And the head, yeah. And so the corpse was missing its head. You know, at first there was some thought, well, you know, maybe the head just, you know, disintegrated in the heat of the fire and so on. But after Belle's crime, and you know, at that point, Belle was portrayed in the newspaper as this heroic mother who had awakened in the middle of the night, and there was this terrible conflagration, and she had rushed to try to save her children, and they'd all died in the fire. Very shortly after that, Helgelian's brother came to LaPorte and was looking around for some evidence that his brother had been there. And along with Belle's current handyman at the time, a guy named Maxon, they began poking around in the yard at these weird spots that seemed to have been relatively recently dug up. And they discovered Helgelian's body. And then they began to dig through the yard and they uncovered all these other remains. So then it became clear the kind of monster Belle Gunness was. And at that point, you know, once they discovered, you know, again, how diabolical she was, they began to think that perhaps that wasn't Belle's body in the cellar after all, you know, that she had lured some woman to the farm, murdered her, decapitated her, staged the whole thing and gotten away with a crime. And, you know, we don't know to this day exactly what happened. I mean, that's a mystery that has persisted, you know, for over 100 years. There are still historians of crime who are trying to determine, you know, whether that corpse was Belle's or whether perhaps she had gotten away.
Now, let me ask this. If I'm understanding what you just said correctly, it was him and a handyman that began to dig up these mass graves. At the discovery of the first body, I would have stopped and called in the police. Is that what happened?
Well, yeah. Yes, that is what happened.
Okay.
Yeah. As soon as they dug up the first one, they contacted the local sheriff. So, you know, a bunch of lawmen and other authority figures immediately came to the farm and, you know, the medical examiner and so on and so forth. So, yeah, I mean, Helgelian's brother and Maxon, you know, as soon as they dug up the first corpse, they got in touch with the authorities. And then what happened was the farm became this incredible tourist attraction. You know, the Sunday after these bodies were exhumed, about 20,000 people descended on the farm. They were running excursion trains from Chicago. They were setting up, you know, it was a carnival.
Oh, yeah.
There were people.
P.T. Barnum would have had a field day with that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, but there were people, you know. Yeah,
now, if she was playing, okay, I'm trying to put all this together in my head as a law enforcement officer, and also I'm very, very interested in forensics. But if she was planning on faking her own death, let's say, just to kind of get away from this, you know, it's getting a little bit too hot for me here, so I'm going to fake my own death. Yeah. We know that she had no compunction whatsoever of killing men or, you know, potential bachelors or husbands. But was there any females that came up missing around that time that would kind of explain this headless female body?
Well, I mean, not specifically. However, we do know for sure that she was capable of killing females, because one of the corpses that was dug out of her hog lot was that of her own 16-year-old foster daughter, a young woman named Jenny. Yeah, she, you know, Belle, again, who had this very, very complicated relationship to children. You know, there was this weirdly maternal quality to her, according to, you know, the testimony of her contemporaries, and she was always very desperate, you know, to have children. And at some point, when she persuaded a family she was close to to turn over this newborn infant to her. The mother died in childbirth, and the father was already very, very burdened, you know, with raising a bunch of other kids. And he agreed to turn over this little girl named Jenny to Belle. She was never formally adopted, but Belle raised her from infancy. And then, again, around early 1908, late 1907, Belle announced to people that she was sending Jenny off to a seminary in California, and then Jenny disappeared. And apparently, again, we don't know for sure, but you know, but the strong sense is that Jenny had become aware, you know, of what was going on in the farm. It would have been hard not to at that point. So Belle, you know, murdered and dismembered her own 16-year-old stepdaughter, foster daughter.
Yeah, well, she very well did take the same path as the handyman.
Yeah. So you know, to answer your question, she was certainly capable of murdering, you know, a member of her own sex. But there is no record of any specific woman, you know, who had gone missing. Although there was talk at the time, you know, there were certain witnesses who claimed that, you know, that they had seen some woman arrive at the farm from Chicago, you know, that perhaps Belle had hired as a maid or something, and who disappeared.
Yeah, because as I listen to this story, I'm kind of reminded of a situation right here in Huntsville, Alabama. We call it the Black Widow of Hazel Green, Elizabeth Rout. And she married six, maybe seven husbands and was accused of killing all of them. Actually stood trial for it and was released because there wasn't any proof, and she chose poison. So the reason that we're able to reenact, you know, her situation is because we have so many written records of how people described her. So in your situation, how did her neighbors or her friends or people in the town describe her character otherwise?
You know, they found her to be a difficult person to get along with. there was apparently a lot of conflict with her neighbors, various disputes over farm animals wandering over, one or the other property. But, nobody had any, and when her second husband, Peter Gunness, to whom she only remained married to for about 8 months, died under very, very, very suspicious circumstances. Supposedly he had gone into the kitchen to fetch his shoes, which he liked to keep near the stove to warm up and dry off after working in the fields all day. And he bent over to get the shoes, and supposedly when he straightened up, he knocked into a sausage grinder that was standing on the stove. And the sausage grinder supposedly fell off and hit him in the head, and he died that night of this injury. And this struck many of the locals as a highly improbable story. And an inquest was held, and ultimately, the medical examiner ruled that it was an accident. But many people in the community at that point, especially, began to look askance, at Belle. But she was, not fully integrated into the community in the sense that, again, she's pretty much stayed by herself. Although I guess she was a very regular churchgoer. So that did speak in her favor, to the townspeople. But for the most part, you get the sense that, there's a great deal of hostility between her neighbors and Belle.
That sounds just like our story here. But, I mean, let's be intellectually honest here, Harold. He knocked a sausage grinder over on his head.
Yeah. Well,
we all know that sausage grinders vice grip to the edge of a table.
I guess this one was loose. Yeah, I mean, there were, again, a lot of questions about it.
Like Russian collusion to me.
Yeah, well, and also she'd already, her previous husband had also died under quite suspicious circumstances. She was married to this guy whose name was Matt Sorensen at the time. She was married to him for about 8 years. They were living in Chicago, and she had persuaded him to, he had a life insurance policy, which, as I remember, was worth around $2,000 in like 1898 money, considerably more in today's money. And she persuaded him that he needed more insurance, so he took out like a $3,000 policy. And there was a single day of the week when both policies would have overlapped, and on that particular day, he returned home from work. He was a watchman, a night watchman at a Chicago department store, seemingly very hale and hearty. And after dinner, suddenly got really sick and then died. And, it was like the only day on which Belle could have collected on both policies. So, So, and the people, and after Peter Gunness died, I mean, there were people who were aware, that her husband's tended to die after being highly insured under strange circumstances, but again, she managed to get away with both of those crimes.
And that leads me to my next question. I mean, I understand. I know that back then we did not have the advantage of social media and the internet and everything. But let's count them up. At the beginning of the interview, you said there's a possibility of 12 victims that we know of, that we know of.
Yeah.
Well, let's say 3 or 4 into it, did these men not get any type of a warning or somebody say, hey, you might want to rethink this one because she's been through 4, 5, 6 husbands? I mean, what was the attraction?
Well, I mean, yeah. Well, these guys never got a chance to be husbands. You know, as with Helpline, what happened was, you know, they would show up at her farm. She would often encourage them to bring their life savings with them. But in the event that they didn't, as was the case with Helgeline, you know, she made sure that as soon as they showed up, they wired, you know, all their money from their local banks to the LaPorte Bank and then withdrew it. But as soon as she had the money in her hands, she killed them. So, I mean, she didn't marry any of these guys. You know, it wasn't like, you know, people were saying, they were saying, hey, you know, this woman's already been married 6 times and nobody knows what happened to previous husbands. You know, these were guys that nobody knew. You know, she would often tell people that she would usually tell people, you know, because people did notice, you know, these guys were coming and then, like, disappearing. You know, she would just tell them that they were relatives, cousins from Norway, you know, who had dropped by for a visit. But she would dispatch them very, very quickly. So, I mean, in that sense, she was different from the traditional black widow, you know, or the male Bluebeard killer, you know, who marries a succession of spouses and then kills them. You know, she was just luring them to the farmhouse and then killing them right away.
Do you think the kids, the children, were aware of her killing these men, or what do you think the kids were thinking?
Yeah. We don't really know that. I suspect, you know, that she committed the crimes, you know, with a certain amount of discretion in the household. As I'm sure we all know, you know, there's a lot of denial that goes on. You know, there are people who live in very close proximity often, you know, to all kinds of horrendous killers, and somehow manage to turn a blind eye to it. And, you know, the kids were very, very young. They just might not have really understood anything that was particularly going on. You know, Belle might have told them, oh, this is your uncle, whatever. You know, then the guy would disappear 2 days later, you know, and she would just tell him, you know, he had to go back to wherever. So, I don't know. I suspect that the children had no real sense of what was going on, except for Jenny, you know, who's considerably older.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, had witnessed something or gotten wise to something, which is why she had to be disposed of.
Yeah. It just, I would think it would be pretty tricky doing all that with the kids, you know, coming and going and being around, and being snoopy, how kids are.
Yeah. Well, I think, there is some indication, you know, that, you know, she made the cellar off limits to them, because there was some testimony by a teacher that the kids had come into school one day very, very, very upset, you know, because Belle had gotten furiously angry at them for having, you know, started to go into the cellar. So, you know, as far as that goes, you know, I don't think they had a full awareness of what was going on.
Do you think she was getting a thrill out of cutting up the men?
Yes, I do think so. You know, because there was no need to do it. You know, to me, again, this is what makes Belle a true serial murderer, because the way I understand the phenomenon of what we now call serial murder, which is a kind of crime that has always existed, although it used to have different names, you know, there's always an element of sadistic pleasure, you know, that the perpetrator takes in inflicting, you know, some kind of, you know, bodily mutilation on the victim. So I do think that, because, again, there's no need to do it. And, you know, when you imagine, you know, what she was doing, you know, again, taking these guys who had come out there, you know, believing instilling in these potential victims, the sense that they're going to be living these lives of ease and luxury, and she would be caring for them. You know, in her letters to Andrew Helgelian, she describes, she tells him, oh, you've been working so hard all these years, and now you deserve to be taken care of. I'm going to be feeding you all of this, Norwegian food that will evoke the memories of home, just spinning this, again, really what is ultimately this sadistic fantasy, knowing what she really has planned for him. And then again, the guy comes there and, within 24 or 48 hours, he's just this piece of dead meat on this butcher block. you have to have a very, very powerfully sadistic component in order to do something like that.
What do you think was the changing point? I know with her husbands, she didn't cut them up. And the last one, he got hit over the head and then all that stuff. So what all of a sudden changed?
Well, in those cases, yeah. Do that if she was hoping to collect on the insurance money, which was obviously, the main motive in terms of getting rid of her husband. I don't know. I mean, it's a good question. I'm not exactly sure. I think possibly, she now had a kind of, lair, a murder lair, in which she could give vent to these, these terrible impulses. Before that, she was always living, she lived with, her first husband in Chicago. It's possible that her pathology just escalated. Once she tasted blood, as it were, once she got away with murder a couple of times, and that, she allowed herself really to give vent, to her most monstrous impulses.
Wow. That's quite a story here. So did anybody ever say they saw her after the fire, or she was discovered anywhere?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there was, eh?
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Kind of like Elvis.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, there are sightings of her all over the world. And they continue for decades. And in fact, toward the end of my book, I talk about this one case. In the 1930s, there was a woman named Esther Carlson in Los Angeles who was arrested after poisoning. She was a housekeeper for some guy, and she poisoned him. And she also apparently, it turned out, poisoned a husband. When the police searched her rooms, they discovered a trunk in which there was a photograph of these young children that were identified as Belle's children. And there were immediate stories, big headlines that Esther Carlson was Belle Gunness. And the newspapers in Los Angeles would run photographs, juxtaposing portraits of Belle and portraits of Esther Carlson. She actually had, I get tuberculosis, I believe. Anyway, she died before she could be brought to trial. But they brought some people from La Porte who had known Belle to view the corpse in the mortuary. And these people positively identified her as Belle Gunness. It turns out that she probably wasn't Belle Gunness. There's been a guy from Selbu, Norway, in recent years, very obsessed with the case, and he came over here and did very, very extensive research into Esther Carlson's background. There's actually a YouTube lecture you can see that he gives on the subject, and he came to the conclusion that Esther Carlson was not Belle Gunness. But for many, many years, people were convinced that she was. Certainly in the immediate aftermath of the crime, Belle was spotted in all over the United States, up in Canada, in Mexico, in Paris, everywhere. Yeah, as you say, like, you know, Elvis and many other notorious criminals that get away. So,
yeah, so. That's just crazy. Well,
yeah.
Well, it's been a very interesting story, and the book is fantastic. We'll have it linked up on our website, as well as anybody can go right to Harold Schechter's website. It's haroldschechter.com. Harold, thank you very much for taking the time to talk about Hell's Princess.
Yeah, my pleasure. Yeah, thank you for having me on the show.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Stamps.com is the best.
It's like somebody dropped the post office on my desk.
It's faster and cheaper and makes us more productive.
Stamps.com solved my shipping problem.
I don't have to go to the post office. I don't have to stand in lines.
There's nothing worse than going to the post office and waiting in line.
Stamps.com makes it easy.
Easy, 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 easy. It makes it simple, and there was no learning curve.
All you need is a computer and a printer. And an internet connection.
Everything you need, you have already.
Setting it up was really easy.
Just download the software and print the stamps in a matter of minutes.
Probably took 5 minutes. The program is brilliant.
Postage meters are extremely expensive.
Postage meters have a tendency to jam.
Ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk. Can you print only stamps? No. First class?
Priority mail.
Parcel.
Next day air.
International.
FedEx.
Tracking information.
Insurance.
It's official U.S. postage.
You could run an entire shipping receiving department with stamps.com.
And the mailman picks it up.
I don't leave the shop anymore.
It's a no-brainer.
It's a post office in our office.
I like it.
To find out more about our show, guests, or listen to a previous show, visit our website at www.somethingweirdmedia.com.
The mission has been completed.
The end!
By George, he's got it! It is the end!
I'll see you.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.
This has been a production of Something Weird Media.